very good acoustics, so if anybody's speaking, try to speak louder so they can hear them. So I guess we'll start off, and is there any public comments? All right, I guess then we'll move for the approval of the minutes of the last meeting. We have a copy and go through that.
Get extra copies in the meeting.
Make a motion that we approve the minutes.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
All right. So move. All right, now the final preparation for the ag form.
Yeah, so so far we have 37 pre-registered from, I think, 17 different towns. So it's looking a lot better than it did about 4 days ago, when we had 12. And I'm counting another 10 presenters who might all have lunch. And then a few exhibitors that probably have lunch. We're up close to 50, so I think we're going to say 45 lunches. We usually have some left over. I guess there are various things we ought to just make sure we're good on. The coffee in the morning, all right, that's going to be provided.
The students from the FFA students do coffee.
Okay. How about like sodas or something later, or water for during the day? Bring a bunch of sodas and waters, you know, and cups, so that we have something for people later.
And you can get ice cream culinary, you know, top or something.
I can check with
you. Yeah, well, the FFA is going to be coffee morning.
Okay. Is coffee still available during the morning? Yeah, that'd be nice.
Yeah, what's that stuff?
Yeah,
well, the whole thing.
Is donuts included? Are donuts?
Yeah.
They have data.
All right.
Oh, I didn't know what you're asking.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, if I remember it from last year, they kept the
donuts. So Wayne is bringing a flip chart, a tripod, and we got a laptop and a projector. We thought one thing we ought to have is a list of the pre-registrants with contact info, you know, and the speakers. So, because one of the ideas is to do as much networking as possible, get people tied into other folks who are here. So I'll try to do that. Wayne, what else do we need to go over?
Well, just the breakouts. So we have this room and the library. The question is, we get to sessions. We have one big group for everything, and we break into two groups, so it's more conversation, and you know that I do.
I think at this point, Phil Corman's going to moderate again the roundtable. We were thinking just keep everybody in the same place and not try to break out.
I mean, if you've got 37 people, I mean, it's not like you've got 80 people.
No, it's not a huge number.
Right.
I mean, that would probably work because the farmer's market's going to be here.
Yeah.
They're going to be running. They set up outside the cafeteria. And they'll take up the hallway all the way down through that.
Are they in here too?
No, they will not be in there. On Saturdays when nothing's going on, they've been in here. The ski and skate sale, and I think there was another event that we had in the cafeteria at the same time. When we put them in the hallway, they were able to shrink down a little bit and use the hallway, so it worked out.
That'd be good. There'd be a lot of activity.
Yeah. So actually, if we stayed in here, it would work better if we didn't go into the library, because they would be set up. I mean, if we could somehow move it, if we're definitely going to use it. But if we don't think we
better to stay in one place.
Yeah.
So, is there a microphone to use?
Yeah, we can get the microphone stuff. The podium. mics up there, we can call you. The other thing would be like cafeteria, how do we want to, last time, if I remember, we had left most of these tables in, and we just did a perimeter ring. I think I don't know if we use the folding tables, or if we use these, or what we have.
We had a perimeter ring.
We had a perimeter ring with tables, we had these that we just kind of fold closer.
Yep.
But I can't remember.
I think we had these pulled back.
Yeah.
Do we use the table with the seats, or one of those seats?
For?
The vendors.
I can't remember, I mean, I was.
We had regular folding tables.
I think we had regular folding tables, or we could just use those with the seats. Put them all together so that the vendor, if somebody wanted to sit in the vendor's box,
we're so funny.
You know, they could just, you know, they could be on that side, keep it simple, meaning that way it would be, you know, more set up, but I mean, if anybody else thought that it would be better to have the other folding tables, I mean, I don't think it really matters too much.
It's more complicated, right?
Yeah. So we'll do a perimeter ring around the, and then how many other vendors come, they can, whether they take a half a table, or if they can take the whole table, maybe, for space.
So, is there somebody from the Northampton Ag Council who kind of give a welcome?
So the mayor's trying to come. You guys asked him about that, but
yeah.
I think it'll be quick, you know, his basically welcome our campus, isn't that wonderful? And then from our John?
Yeah.
Right.
Great. Okay, and then I'll probably say a few words just for, you know, the department and housekeeping stuff. And then Dick Ward is going to be here for the MAAC, so he'll probably talk for 5 minutes.
I've got to make sure that the microphone won't play.
So rather than saying we just have each person choose the next person, so the mayor can choose you.
Good. So we're going to set up at starting 7:30. What else do we need to do?
Okay. I mean, so for like the setup at 7:30, I mean, I don't think we all, I mean, do you think everybody needs to be
no.
here? Because on Friday afternoon, when it's done, I mean, I'll be able, I can set these tables up around the outside perimeter, and there'll be a custodian here already for the farmer's market, and they can open the building up.
Sure, well, that's great.
So if there's vendors that come already,
that could be a lot to do early.
Yeah.
We'll get the projector set up. We'll get the table set up for people who have exhibits.
Yeah, they could pretty much, like I said, we could do all that Friday afternoon.
Yeah.
I mean, what are we expecting people at 8:30? I mean, the thing starts at 9?
Registration is 8:30. Yeah. It starts at 9.
Okay.
Yeah.
I mean, are we just checking people off? I mean, we'll walk in and so
on. Yeah, Phil Corman offered to do that. So
okay.
He's going to sit at the table and take the money and check them off.
Right.
And we'll have name tags.
You
think
we
have?
I think
so. Yeah.
Well, I mean, with the farmer's market,
yeah, we could put it right
inside the door with a sign or something, maybe.
Well, yeah, a sign at the door would be good. Too,
right.
So
that we know where to go, but we don't want to take up their space too.
He signs from. They got the email. So it was. He is including the beverage at the lunch.
Okay.
I don't know what it is. Okay. So if you want to make something scrappy.
We're good for extension cords and all that stuff.
Yeah, we'll have extension cords. There's some right in the closet over here, but I'll bring, we can bring some extra over here. And what about the screen? When you that's simple enough on the stage, we get a screen that drops down.
Did we do a screen last year?
No, we didn't.
Yeah, we'll need a screen of some kind.
Yeah,
for the
and we're hearing
it
here.
Is it a hand truck or a dowel or anything that they want to be? If they're not wanting to so far.
For vendors. Yeah.
How many vendors have come from here?
I haven't heard from vendors except for one or two.
I know Vince from the NRCS is coming. I don't know.
Okay.
You know, but he's
Greenfield Farmers Exchange will be here. I know Origin Equipment will be here.
Later. We are going to have two short speakers during lunch too. Because otherwise we can't, there's no time to get them in.
So the lunch, are we going to have the lunch in here then?
Yeah.
Okay, so just so the culinary will know that. And you know, if you plan on setting stuff up in the restaurant or what you can, comes in.
Well, is that convenient to have lunch? I mean, if you want everybody in the middle place for lunch, then it's
well, not but then, there. Then we wouldn't have a microphone. Well, we wouldn't have a microphone.
Yeah, this is.
Yeah.
But it's kind of
easy to get
stuff
in the
attic. Yeah,
go in there, get their lunch.
Yeah,
get here with the lunch. And then we'll
have a lunch. We'll
just give them
instructions, you know, just before lunch, tell where he goes.
Okay. Let's have a talk with the culinary tomorrow, just to let him know that we'll actually be, that's the plan that we'll be meeting here, so that he won't think he's got to give us 90 minutes for supper. Or however he wants to set up serving. Yeah, or he may want to set up, I don't know if he want to set up tables here or something to serve in, or what, you know.
Yeah, whatever.
Yeah, we'll figure it out.
Do you know if the lunch is going to be discrete quantities like a sandwich, or is it going to be something you dish out? Because
discrete quantities, that's the point.
Discrete quantities. So that makes it a little harder to, in case you get walk-ins, you know. But it's too bad if they walk in, they're not getting their lunch.
And some people want
to. I'd rather have, less leftover. We've got to pay for the leftover.
Yeah. I would imagine, doing it that way, you get, anybody who's paid for lunch or whatever, go over to the restaurant, grab the lunch.
Yeah. And then we're adjourning at 3 o'clock, so I'm assuming we'll clean up and be out of here before 4.
Okay. Yeah. I mean, if we just use these tables in here and we'll hold the tables up, there's really not much to do afterwards.
I think
the floor is quite hard to clean up.
You'll have big trash barrels?
Yeah, we'll have all the trash barrels out and stuff all like that ready. Just take the trash out completely. Just ready that now.
Registration at 8:30, and we'll actually start at
9. Yeah, I'll have everything set up. There will be a guy opening the building. Farmers market. We set up there.
I think 8 o'clock probably plenty early. I'm gonna, you know, start registration until 8, and most of the stuff is set up. I mean, that's just sitting around there. Yeah. If there's any last minute details, you can come.
I'll probably get you a little earlier.
Yeah.
You'll be around for at least the morning.
Can I come here and stand?
Yeah, speak up.
that he just added that he, and he's just, it's not right that the, even though it's been reduced, that the farmers that own the property on the other side of the dikes have to pay at least $100 for their individual farming. He's of the feeling that there shouldn't be any charge at all because that land is virtually sacrificial. In other words, anybody that owns land over there, my God, I mean, you know, I'm sure there's people in the audience that know what I'm talking about. If there's a flood, who's going to get hit first?
It's outside the water control system.
So I'm going to make a recommendation that we've got to voice this to the Board of Public Works the first opportunity we've got, because there are no more. And I don't know, I know Wayne, you had talked about this, but apparently there's not enough consent. Now, the other item that he thought would be difficult would be the fact that outside of the dike, inside the city of Northampton, it might not be politically possible to do much to change that. But he felt that the area without the dike area, in other words, beyond the dikes. And I think it's worth an effort myself personally to go to the Board of Public Works.
To a large extent, the Board of Public Works has already laid in into real city council.
Well, then we need to choose the best point of discussion. That's what we need to point.
Because it was one of the councillors, so the Board of Public Works included an exemption of this for permanent protected farmland and a maximum $100 for other ones. And it was one of the councillors who wasn't even sure he wanted to have anything. So that amendment is circulating.
If it went in effect today, we would each pay $100 for one parcel or all our
parcels? No, all of these parcels in your name for what?
So that's one of the comments that I made on your behalf in Conservation Commission. So there's two things. One is what's the base formula? And then what is the Board of Public Works authorized to do? So the Board of Public Works is authorized to come up with a formula for a property owner who owns multiple properties. Create a clause that it's one property for the maximum, but that's not the ordinance itself. It's trusting the Board of Public Works to do something. So one of the comments I made is it would be nice to put the ordinance. You know, even if it's $100, at least you want to know it's definitely $100 not going to grow. And so that's not the ordinance itself. They're trusting the Board of Public Works.
So right now, those of us that have multiple tax bills would be charged $100 for the open space.
So it's up to the Board of Public Works. I think that's what they would do. But this note is not in the ordinance, so they could charge more. So that's one of the comments that I made that you guys should make.
I think again, if that's the point, we have to go to before City Council to do this, then I think we need to do this because that land down there is like I said before, is almost sacrificial. In other words, that's going to bear the brunt of anything that comes down. And I apologize because apparently I'm out of order for this discussion on public access. But I do have a comment on that as well, but good. I'm wondering, I'm just going to throw this out for discussion, whether it would be good, possible to form a subcommittee on this and spend a little more time on this because there's a lot to this. I know we brought this up before. I didn't know if the members of the commission would consider that to be something that would make sense. How the committee would be formed would be discussed, but I think we could spend a little more time.
I'm sorry. Stormwater, you're aware of
that. I'm sorry. Moving on.
Yeah. Okay.
I think the stormwater, we know that we've got to go before City Council. So I think that's more or less it. We want to drag it out.
Okay.
But on the public access issue, which has been receiving a lot of press, and there's a lot of information going around on that, I just wonder whether it would pay to have a subcommittee on this to work on the various issues that are coming up and have a little more time. important. I don't want to lose this place, but we could have more information to bring.
So two approaches. You can do a subcommittee. We're still required in open meeting law to advertise that women's, and so that's fine if you don't want to do it. Or if everyone here is interested, you can do this extra ag commission meeting. That's the only thing on the subject, so it doesn't get buried in everything else. So it really depends on how you are interested in that approach. All of you are interested in extra meetings. I mean, some of you do the subcommittee.
Maybe we want to table it and maybe make a decision at the next meeting on whether, you know, which approach to take. But there's an awful lot of stuff that's coming together here on this, and it seems to me that what really strikes me about this is the fact that when it comes down to the legal issues, we're just commission members. We don't know. We can gather information, but there's an awful lot of, for example, I read an article, a letter to the editor from Michael Pill, I think his name was, from Shrewsbury, that had commented on this whole thing. I believe he's a lawyer. And then I know the Association of Meadows has got a lawyer. And so there's an awful lot of information, but eventually it seems to me that it's coming to more of a legal thing. And there's a lot of precedents and so on and so forth. So I'm wondering whether along with this discussion of all this, whether, with some legal advice involved might be helpful. I'm not just throwing this out and I'm speaking kind of as I go here, but I'm just thought it might be worth it.
No, in essence, that map you all saw, that went through DPW and said all those roads were blue, which were the unknown.
Yeah.
That's it. Their record show is they don't have it.
So that's all, yeah, that stands as it did before.
And one thing that you said was right is, because we're still waiting to hear from this Meadows Farmers group and their attorney, is, maybe we're going to walk, we don't go too far until we get that.
Well, that's what I mean. I thought that I would put it on the table, and nothing, obviously. I just think it's one more thing we can consider. That everybody feels is something important. But I'd like to get it right.
We don't have the equivalent of these dirt roads compared to the year history elsewhere, other than
next to, but, you know, and there are, well, roads that go into some of those areas, probably would be the only thing that would be comparable.
Does it make sense? So just keep going around in terms of the subcommittee of the committee as a whole, and get everybody else to figure out. I know that everyone's talking to everybody else, and there's other combinations going on.
Like, you'll still represent something?
No.
He's a freelance.
He's done a lot of litigating on this subject for other clients. His firm, even though he lives in Tewksbury, he's a firm in our team. Committee and then to the full council. So in terms of showing up a committee, ordinance makes sense. in terms of personal lobbying, frankly,
so I mean, probably the first step would be to find out what the ordinance committee met and then to go to them first, right?
Right, right. You know, we're in this never land between councils, so ordinance committee doesn't exist yet. So they'll be appointing them later this month, and then they're at their first meeting in February. We don't even know who's going to be on that.
Could you keep this interesting?
Yep.
I would think it's very urgent because it seemed to me what the mayor said in his inaugural address that he's pretty interested in getting this thing rolling. The whole thing with this problem is
Well, and I think, you know, the best kind of synergy is to figure out spaces that are easily convertible from one thing to another. You know, so you think about, I'm not suggesting that the spaces wouldn't work, but when the arts night out a couple weeks ago, and there was the open house, the new art space, that was full of sort of, you know, people selling art, people wandering around. You can imagine some kinds of space that might be convertible from one use to another. So I think that fits with more what you're talking about.
You're having, for example, we talked earlier about the fire department is up here at the school now for the winter time. It seems to be something that it's certainly not dying, it's growing. And then we have the daughter's farmers market Saturday. Not looking to create any controversy here, obviously. I know there's a lot of people attached to those things, but if there's a drive to have a year-round farmers market, it seems to be happening. I'm just wondering whether, as a division, we should, and I don't need to pick on this if this is long, but it is a chance for farmers to market their goods year-round. And I'm just wondering whether, again, I know what you're saying, it's obviously it's an expense thing, no doubt about it. But as that area down there by the roundhouse goes along, you know, it might not work. On the other hand, if there's something that's going to be developed down there, I wonder whether there's any sense in making something indoors that could be a combo year-round. Maybe not. There seems to be an area down there that's being looked at, you know, for something. Probably something that's going to be expensive, but beneficial to the city. And again, I'm wondering if there's anything that might make any sense to piggyback something on it.
I mean, at least at this point, I haven't been involved in the process, but the report, and I'm not sure the consensus that went into it, was talking about a garage with housing. And, you know, other than that, that doesn't fit as well. You can imagine some sort of commercial uses would have to be more of a
that picture that the girl from the college showed in her hometown in Michigan was pretty, it was pretty nice. Really, it looked really nice. Again, I mean, it seems like a great place for people to market their look at that. What possibilities are
there? Other thoughts in terms of your priorities and what you've heard in the presentation? So what I'll try to do is when we get the final report, I'll distribute it all to you. What I kind of use one other time is we're also sending sort of, I don't want to say a scoring sheet, but basically a sheet with each of the items on it.
Yep.
So you don't get overwhelmed. So we have the report, and there's even one page sort of summary where all the items are, and those can become, in essence, agenda items. So this is a rich line discussion about a farmer's market. You can go through each one of those items individually and think about what makes sense, you know, what the priority, you know. One of the things I like to know from you all is if you only do, you know, we always think about what's the low hanging fruit, you know, what's the stuff we could do in 6 months. And maybe it's the most important if we can do something. And so we're asking you to think about that. And then maybe we're asking you to think about what are the things, if you could do one big ticket item, which one is it? Is it a permanent farmer's market or something different? So we can sort of think about that. And obviously, even though the students did a really good job, when you read the report, don't just react to what's in the report. Also think about what's not the report. What other thing you wish you had seen there?
Municipal support,
necessary, and it's going to work out or not. And the sense I have from CPA is that you want to put a lot of money on the table, but that more money probably would flow. So that's what we're getting at. Not so much money's gone and done, then we go back to CPA. If you're not going to give us more. We asked for more. You know, it was in the second round. They only gave us $35. But it is the amount of money sitting on the table and give us. So whenever we get it over the PR, we'll go back. The other piece of farmland in terms of bringing it back, we're trying to get you guys to look in, is the old jail farm, prison farm on
Fishersfield
Road. It's owned by the county, county's here, that land went to the state. And so we've had discussions with the Department of Ag Resources about sponsoring legislation to get land transferred to the city or a farmer somehow to get that happen.
How many acres are there?
Not much. You know, I'm guessing, but 8, something like that, of which a couple acres is wetlands. So maybe 5 or 6 is far away.
I should be doing probably back
on that water. Well, yeah, there would be. Yeah.
The good land is already being farmed.
That's a good point.
It's already being taken care of.
But it is possible that it could be built.
Yeah, but Chip is right. It's a portion which the neighbor has been encroaching. Frankly, I'm very glad about that. That means that the brush isn't growing up.
You've got to take care of
it. Right.
You've got to be paying him to maintain it.
That's it about kind of interesting what this farmland should be. You've got to write it. Any land that's good, it's a good productive thing that should be quite well.
Yeah.
The marginal land is the only thing.
First to go.
Right. We acquired a parcel of land for conservation on. Chesterfield Road, and we had hoped we could find somebody who wanted to bring that back, and we haven't been able to. But, you know, same thing is being quite different. part of Harvey's here, but it's more spacing past your land.
Which would have broken there. All rocks.
Go find maybe.
With a brush.
We had a very business profitable.
Right, well, that was, we did a discussion with, who's the guy who raises grass for beef from East Hampton?
Chipwin.
Yeah. So we hoped to attract it to him. That was really the only real bite he had. It was too far and too small.
I'm looking at this again on this recommendation to data. I just want to make one more point here. If you look at the agricultural farmers market, the processing facility, community center, working on local food week, support on the farmers market, and if you group all those together, you know, they're not too far apart from them, you know, in a lot of ways. So, I mean, you could almost condense all this and look at that. So, that's why I wanted to bring that up for discussion, looking at the whole thing.
Yeah.
You know, because it's a possibility that, you know, you might be able to, you know, do something with the recommendations.
And a lot of these, there's a lot of effort in some of these. So, the promoting local farm, you know, food, it's two big efforts. There's the thesis doing a lot of work, and then to a lesser extent, there's Healthy Hampshire, which is a consortium of health in four towns, including Northampton, is trying to promote, you know, local food. So there's individual efforts on a lot of these things. So part of it is that we do a metrics of what's out there, we start talking about who's doing what, so we all know what the efforts are, what are gaps, and what things are.
So the city don't own any more of that land over the Allen Bean Farm. That's all private.
Right. So Grow Food Northampton has that dealt here, about 112 acres,
121.
And then what the city owns is Pleasant Forest right in the river, and then the recreation area. But all the farmland is Grow Food.
Yeah.